I would like to introduce our next speaker is going to talk about the remote diagnosis of important diseases of canines. And he is none other than Dr. Sambhaji Chauhan. He is assistant professor from the Department of Veterinary Pathology, College of Veterinary Sciences, Udgir, Maharashtra. Dr. Sambhaji Chauhan has more than 10 years of experience, and his specialty is regarding the postmortem and clinical pathological diagnosis of various diseases in animals. He has published many research articles, and he has achieved almost the establishment of state-of-the-art postmortem diagnostic facility and veterinary clinical pathology laboratory. And the remarkable thing about him is his three cases got included in Nose Archive, which is a world-renowned trust repository of veterinary pathology image database, which is maintained by Charles Louis Davis and Samuel Wesley Thompson DVM Foundation, USA. So such a big achievement is at the credit of Dr. Sambhaji Chauhan. So such a dynamic pathologist is with us to deliver the topic on the laboratory diagnosis of important diseases of canines. So welcome, Dr. Sambhaji Chauhan. Okay, I request Dr. Sambhaji Chauhan, sir, to please start your presentation, sir.
Okay, please. Sir. Is my voice audible, sir?
Yes, yes, you are audible.
Okay, sir. Can I share, sir?
Yes, sir, you can share.
Okay, just a minute. Okay, sir. Screen visible, sir?
Yeah, yeah. Make it full screen.
Okay, okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Can I start?
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes.
Okay. So, good evening, all.
Chauhan, sir. Chauhan, sir. I would request you to, you can start your video also.
Okay, okay, okay. Just wait 1 minute, sir. Okay, sir. Now it is visible, sir?
Yes, yes, yes. Sure, sure. Very nice.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Okay. Good evening, all. So I think you may have tired now, because back to back, this is third lecture, I think. But I will try to finish whatever fast or whatever speedily it is possible. I think it is 7:30 now. So I will try within a half hour, whatever possible from my side. From last 2 to 3 days, you are going through typically mostly clinical aspects. But this topic, most probably, whatever I am from laboratory side, I'm pathologist. So today we are going to see the different diseases are there, all you people know. How to diagnose these diseases, important diseases. I am not going to cover all diseases of the canines. It is not possible within half hour or 1 hour. But whatever regular diseases we are coming across here, whatever I came across here, that only I am sharing here. Okay, so today we will start. Just 1 minute. Okay, so whatever images today I am going to show, showing here, mostly 90-95% my images are from my side only. But some images I took from other sources, I have acknowledged them. If not, please apologize for, say sorry for me. But 95% images are from my side, and these are the copyright notification. Okay, so as per laboratory diagnosis consider, all you people know, diagnosis typically, these are three types of diagnosis are there. Clinical diagnosis means clinician, he is diagnosing the disease or disorder from his own experience or from going through the history and clinical signs. Second type of diagnosis, that is laboratory diagnosis. So for each and every disease, it is not possible for clinician to diagnose the disease clinically. Number of clinical signs are there, number of histories are there, they are overlapping. So in such circumstances, many times we are taking help of laboratory techniques for diagnosis. And third diagnosis, therapeutic diagnosis. Therapeutic means what? Many times clinicians, they are just suspecting some disease, they are giving some treatment, and they are waiting for response. If positive response is there, our diagnosis is okay. Or if negative response is there, whatever we have suspected, it is not there. So that is called a therapeutic diagnosis. So these three types of diagnosis are there. From last 3 days, I hope you may have gone through the clinical diagnosis and therapeutic diagnosis. Because today we are going to see the laboratory diagnosis. So what techniques are there in canines? I'm talking on number of topics, canines, small ruminants, and all these, this one. But today I have chosen this topic, that is canine diagnosis of canine disease through laboratory techniques. So regularly, N number of techniques nowadays are available for diagnosis of diseases, canine diseases or any diseases. Among them, very frequently, all you people know, that is CBC. CBC is very regular technique. All private practitioners, even our government hospitals, nowadays every hospitals, they are having CBC machines. So although it is machine, it is not giving any interpretation. We have to interpret the result. Machine is giving analysis. Remember, machine never gives any diagnosis. It is only giving count. You have to interpret yourself. You have to correlate the data with your clinical science and other things. Then only you can reach to some diagnosis. So in CBC, what we are going through, that is interpretation. And very important in case of canines, how to approach the anemic patients. So how to diagnose the anemia? What is the cause of anemia? How to diagnose that one? That never machine use. That we have to do. Okay. So that another thing we are going to see. The next one, next very important technique, very simple technique.
Excuse me, Chavan sir. I think some of the participants are saying that presentation is not visible.
What?
You have to reshare the presentation, I think.
Is it visible now, sir?
Not yet.
Regularly, I am using Google Meet. Very rarely, I use this.
Yes.
Just let me share screen. Check, sir, now.
Yeah, it is visible.
Okay, sir.
Now make it full screen.
Okay.
Yes, yes. It is visible. It is visible. Yes.
Okay.
Some are unable to see, but most of them are able to see.
Okay, sir.
Maybe the technical problem. Maybe.
Okay, sir. Just tell me in between. So again, I will.
Okay, sir. Continue. Okay, sir.
Second technique, that is from ages behind or now till today we are using, that is blood smear examination. Nowadays, number of techniques are available. Multiple techniques are available. Then also till today, this technique is very important or very easy for any laboratory technician or any pathologist or for any clinician or field veterinarian. That is blood smear examination. Why we are going for blood smear examination? In blood smear examination, normally we are going for to assess the size of cells, shape of cells, and very important count of number of various cells. Second one, many times we are suspecting for some disease, that is detection of infectious agents. That may be sometimes babesias are in canines, number of diseases are there, they can be diagnosed with the blood smear examination. And very important, again, very important measure that in few cases that can be assessed, that is hematological malignancies. Maybe leukemias may be there, or many malignant neoplastic or cancers are there, hematological malignancies are there. They can be also diagnosed with the help of blood smears. So for these three reasons, we are going for blood smear examination. Again, many times we are going for wet mounts. Although we are going for CBC, blood smear means we are staining that cells. We are killing that cells. Okay, and then we are staining by imparting some color. But in some cases, you have to go for wet mount, direct mount. That is immunomated hemolytic anemia or immunomated thrombocytopenia. For diagnosis of immunomated hemolytic anemia in canines or felines, this is very important technique. That is wet mount examination. Then trypanosomiasis. Maybe in canines or bovines, very frequently we are using wet mounts. We are taking directly the drop of blood, anticoagulated blood on the smear, putting coverslip and going for examination without staining. Okay. Again, these wet mounts even can be used in case of fecal samples also, urine samples also. They are very useful for diagnosing number of diseases. Again, next technique is fine needle aspiration cytology. That is very commonly we are using for neoplastic disease diagnosis or cancer diagnosis. Okay, again, it is very quick and easy technique. A number of diagnosis, neoplastic disorders easily can diagnose with these cytological techniques. The next one, histopathology, although it is cumbersome technique, but today I am showing some lesions, they will help definitely easily to diagnose these number of typically viral diseases. Okay. Then lateral flow assays also nowadays available. That is, you may have seen pancreatic, endocrine, or some infectious agents, lateral flow assays. That's the rapid diagnostic kits. You may have seen the lateral flow assays. Nowadays they are available for pancreatic disease diagnosis also. Infectious diseases like ehrlichiosis, borreliosis, heartworm infection. These three or four techniques I will show later on. Okay. Then urine analysis also again very important technique. Nowadays we are using, frequently we are using, that is sediment cytology for diagnosis of neoplastic disorders, maybe transitional cell carcinoma, prostate cell carcinoma. And again, nowadays dipsticks are available. Although very few companies, they are providing dipsticks, they are standardized for veterinary purpose. But many veterinarians, they are using dipsticks from human side also. Then skin scraping. So these are these few techniques or some techniques they are normally we are using for diagnosis of canine disease. So now we'll see one by one. Okay, first one is CBC. So already I told, what is the purpose of CBC? First one, cell count. From CBC, we are going to assess the cell counts, neutrophils, lymphocytes, eosinophils, and platelet. Normally, the neutrophil count and platelet counts, they are very much important, remember. Whenever neutrophilia is there, we are suspecting that may be bacterial infection. But remember, neutrophilia always never predict the bacterial infection. Why? You have to ask for the history. Sometimes, many times previously, that patient may have been administered corticosteroids or anti-inflammatory drugs. Check that history. Otherwise, these anti-inflammatory drugs, when already previously administered, they are responsible for causing mature neutrophilia. And these machines, they are showing neutrophilia. So don't just confuse with neutrophilia that is induced by drug administration and that is real neutrophilia. So you have to check the history of patient before assessing the neutrophilia. Then lymphocytes and eosinophils are there. But remember, lymphocytes very commonly you will see in leukemia. Eosinophils, you will see eosinophilia, increase in eosinophil count very commonly in parasitic or allergic infections. But I have seen one or two cases eosinophilic granuloma. In eosinophilic granuloma or inflammatory bowel disease, IBD, you may see clumps of eosinophils, they are present in canines or felines. So these suspicions you should keep mind whenever you are getting increased eosinophil count. Again, thrombocytosis is not that much important clinical point of view, but thrombocytopenia is very much important, remember. And many our clinicians, even pathologists also, laboratory people also, they are relying fully, whole and soul on the machines. Remember, no any machine is there that correctly can give platelet count. Many machines nowadays, whatever we are having in setup, they are impedance-based machines. Remember, they are not laser-based machines. Laser-based machines are somewhat okay. But impedance-based machines, they are giving many times false reading for platelet count. So in your thrombocytopenia is there, kindly don't forget to check the blood smears. What happens when you are storing the blood for a long duration, that is for a whole night? What happens sometimes we are getting samples during evening hours. We are storing these samples in refrigerators. And in morning hours, we are going for CBC count. So what happens? These platelets get clumped. And these clumps, they are measured by these machines as some RBCs or some other cells. And we are getting thrombocytopenia. So in such circumstances, don't forget to see the blood smears. Always thrombocytopenia should be assessed or correlated with blood smear finding. Definitely you'll get clumps are there. So if clumps are there, if blood smear adequate number of platelets are there, the machine is not wrong. Remember, machine is working on impedance-based technology. So when your clumps are there, they're counting these cells as something different. And it automatically count get decreased, that is thrombocytopenia. So for this platelet count or thrombocytes, please kindly correlate your findings, correlate your counts always with the blood smear examination. Don't directly say it is thrombocytopenia. Then morphologically very important findings you should always keep in your mind, that is toxic changes. Toxic changes means normally these neutrophils, they are granulocytes, but their granules are not visible in staining. Typically gram-negative bacterial infections, you will find their cytoplasm become basophilic. And their granules are visible. They are showing clumps, that is called a dole bodies. So whenever you are getting toxic changes, ask if neutrophilia is there, ask your pathologist or your laboratory person, either they are having toxic changes. If toxic changes are there, this term basically came from human side. That is, dole bodies, toxic changes, they came from human side. normally we are suspecting that animal or that patient is having gram negative bacterial infection. Okay, toxic changes, it shift to left and all these things are there. When you are getting anemia, machine is showing hemoglobin is less, your PCV count is less. So what type of that anemia is that is very important for clinical persons. Is it is regenerative anemia or non-regenerative anemia? Only seeing anemia is very easy. No need of any pathologist or any technical person. How you get idea it is regenerative or non-regenerative? Remember, you have to see the blood smear. If anemia is there, and you in blood smear you are getting numerous immature polychromatic cells or nucleated RBCs. So it clearly indicates bone marrow is working. Hemolytic anemia is there, bone marrow is working. If we treated that animal for particular cause, definitely that anemia will cover because bone marrow is working. Okay, so you should ask the laboratory person either that anemia is regenerative or non-regenerative. That is very important. Again, already I discussed what are the issues with CBC machines. Many times we are sending samples. I have got very bad experience with these human laboratories. Remember, they never process sample again. They never will see the blood smear. So kindly don't rely on these human machines. Canines, it's okay, but other species, typically sheep, goats, and bovines, I got very bad results with these human machines. So always with machines, they are certified. They have been standardized for veterinary purpose. Always rely on these machines. These human sides pathologist or pathology lab, they never run machine samples again and again. In veterinary practice, normally when we are getting some abnormalities, we are going for blood smear. I never seen any pathologist in human side. They are nowadays going for blood smear. They are not at all going for blood smear. They are just relying on the machines. So when you are sending samples for human laboratories, kindly check your findings with some other machines. Or just confirm your findings by correlating with clinical science and all these things. Thrombocytopenia, already I told, always check thrombocytopenia with blood smears. Don't completely or don't always rely on the machines for assessing thrombocytopenia. Okay, these are some text points regarding CBC. Now we'll go for blood smear examination. Now, hereafter, I will not show any text. Hardly two to three initial slides are there. This text are there. Otherwise, it is just like Atlas. I want virtual presentation. I don't want any text. Okay. So that whatever I am talking, that will be visible in front of you. I will not show any text. Now, first we will go for canines. This is list of canines. And even some feline diseases also I am having, I will show. Hardly one is there. Okay. So initially we will go for canine babesiosis. All you people know this is very big issue in canine practice. That may be small babesia, that is Babesia gypsumi. Although we are talking, interpreting as a Babesia gypsumi, but molecular, if you want for molecular differentiation, that may be something different. So, but generally, whenever we are getting small Babesia, we are just identifying them as a Babesia gypsumi. Large Babesia, that is Babesia canis. Okay, so these two species normally, they are responsible for causing canine babesiosis. Then Mycoplasma hemocanis. So although it is rare or somewhat less, but many times, near about three or four times I have seen these cases, and if very severe anemia is there, inflammatory response is there, and these animals are succumbing. Okay, so Mycoplasma hemocanis canis diagnosis also we'll see. Canine trypanosomiasis also there. You may have heard about bovine trypanosomiasis. In bovines it is very common, but in canines also nowadays prevalence is increasing day by day. That is canine trypanosomiasis. Then canine hepatogenosis, that is again very chronic infection. And again, it is responsible for wasting in canines. Canine ehrlichiosis, again, after babesiosis, this is one major problem, canine ehrlichiosis. That may be monocytic ehrlichiosis, granulocytic ehrlichiosis, or thrombocytic. Okay, so normally we'll get ehrlichia canis, that is monocytic, and canine ehrlichiosis, that is thrombocytic, that is anaplasma platys. So they are responsible for causing ehrlichiosis or thrombocytopenia typically in canines. Then one case I am having, that is from feline side. Although today we are talking about canines, but this is only single case is there. Trichomonas fetus associated feline diarrhea. You may have heard in bovines, Trichomonas fetus and Trichomonas whatever it is there. They are responsible for abortion, but nowadays trend is changing. You may see many articles are there. They are showing that Trichomonas fetus is associated with feline diarrhea. Even in canines also few reports are there. So the simple technique you can diagnose that Trichomonas. I came across one or two cases. Trichomonas fetus associated feline diarrhea. Then spirocercalupi is there, that we'll see later on. Okay. So first we'll see canine babesiosis. All you people are clinical side. So you know very well tick-borne infection, Very commonly, these two species they are responsible for Canon babesiosis, that is Babesia gypsumae and Babesia canis. Very important, this is very big threat for racing greyhounds and pit bull terriers. For clinical findings, fever, that is very important. Again, weakness is depression is there due to anemia. Abnormally dark urine, dark red urine, hemoglobin urea in some cases, that is chronic babesiosis cases. Then frequently we'll see pale mucous membranes are there. In some cases, we'll see ectopic mucous membranes are there. But I've seen some cases, they are having around 30 to 14 hemoglobin, gram per deciliter. Then also, they are HIV positive for Babesia gypsumae. So in such cases, never will suspect because mucous membranes are consistent. What happened? When these animals are getting infected, they are not taking food or water for long duration. Anorexia is there. And that is leads to dehydration, again, hemoconcentration. And their mucous membranes are congested. And we are, normally we have a habit, when your pale ectopic mucous membranes are there, we are suspecting there may be some hemolytic disease. So I have seen some cases. So you have to check all of the blood smear examination. Laboratory techniques is used for diagnosis of in these cases, for the diagnosis of babesiosis in these cases. Okay. Then again, swollen lymph nodes are there. Petechial or ecchymotic hemorrhages are there in gums or ventral abdomen. If you go on for sonography or something, other techniques, x-ray, you'll see hepatosplenomegaly is there due to hemolytic crisis or overload. So this burden, lytic burden, RBC, erythrocytes, they are getting lysed. Heavy lysis is there. And this is spleens, liver, there are very good sites for disposal of lysed RBCs. So workload is there, function load is there. That's how you'll see hepatosplenomegaly is there in this hemolytic diseases. Now, as per laboratory tests are considered, laboratory findings are considered, you will see marked anemia is there, very commonly regenerative anemia is there. But in few patients, you will see, in chronic patients, you will see there is no regenerative anemia, regenerative response is there. You will see a non-degenerative, mild non-degenerative response is there. Again, thrombocytopenia, that is very important feature of canine babesiosis. Always don't say thrombocytopenia I am getting means that is canine ehrlichiosis or tick bite cure. It is not like that one. Thrombocytopenia is very frequent feature of the canine babesiosis. Then hyperbilirubinemia is there due to jaundice or hemolytic jaundice. Then hyperglobulinemia is there due to immunomodulatory responses. Many times immunomodulatory hemolytic anemia is concurrently found in case of canine babesiosis. Then autoagglutination of erythrocytes, that is a very important thing I am going to tell today. Why always we should check for the IMHA in case of babesiosis? Because number of cases I have seen, near about 35% cases are there. When your babesiosis is there, always there is immunomodulatory hemolytic anemia is there. Immunomodulatory response is there. So although there is successful anti-babesial treatment is there, then also anemia continues. Destruction of RBCs, lysis of RBCs continues and patient will succumb. Patient dies. Same thing I have seen in bovines also. So whenever we are getting confirmed case of babesiosis or other lytic diseases, typically some neoplasias also there, always check for this immunomodulatory hemolytic anemia. They are the big culprit and we are not suspecting. We are thinking Babesia is there. I have given correct treatment and definitely that dog or cat will recover. But that dog dies. That anemia, hemoglobin level never increase and these patients are dying. So whenever you are having these cases, kindly check for immunomodulatory hemolytic anemia. How to check that I will show later. Okay. So very important feature of babesiosis, that is babesiosis associated immunomodulatory hemolytic anemia. Continued hemolysis despite of successful anti-babesial treatment. That is very important. Normally we are not considering it. Then dogs that have survived babesiosis often remain subclinically infected, remember. Okay. Then dogs recovered from babesiosis should never be used as a donors. Already I told, their subclinical infection is there. There is no complete recovery is there, remember, in Babesia infected dogs. Very rarely recovery is there. These dogs never should be identified as a donors for blood transfusions. So always ask the owner, if that dog is having some previous history of this babesiosis or other diseases, we should not select these dogs for as a donors. That will transmit the disease to the other healthy animals. Then prognosis in case of babesiosis is always bad. This thing nobody need to tell you because all your clinical side. Okay, we'll start. So this is just, I think, 1 or 2 months back, I got this case. This is already I told, canine babesiosis is caused by majorly these two species, that is Babesia gypsumae and Babesia canis. Babesia gypsumae is small Babesia. Babesia canis is large Babesia. So why it is called as small? You will just get idea after two or three slides. Just you can see here, they are very small and signature in shape. Although these organisms are pleomorphic, you can say they may be signature in shape, rod shape, or sometimes in dot shape also. But frequently we'll see they are having signature in shape. Just you can see this cursor. Okay, many are with intrahepatic signature in shape. This pyroplasm, Babesia gibsoni pyroplasm, they are present within erythrocytes. Again, I talked about the regenerative anemia. Whenever we are sending the sample, you are getting low hemoglobin. You should ask pathologist either it is regenerative or non-regenerative. How to assess? Just you can see here, because this dog is having severe heavy infection of Babesia gibsoni. So hemolytic crisis is there. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4 numerous polychromatic cells are there. So whenever hemoglobin is less, you are getting numerous immature. These are polychromatic means what? They are immature RBCs. As demand of RBCs increase before maturation, they are thrown into circulation by bone marrow, because demand is more than the production. Demand is more than production in case of hemolytic diseases. So what happened? You see these immature cells, they are thrown into circulation. So whenever you are getting these numerous polychromatic cells, nucleated RBCs, so your bone marrow is working. When I am treating this dog for Babesia, anti-babesial treatment, definitely that anemia will recover because bone marrow is working. If bone marrow is not working, typically in chronic renal failure, then some hepatic diseases, bone marrow depression or bone marrow destruction, where from cells will come? They never will come. In such circumstances, although anemia is there, never will find these polychromatic cells or immature RBCs. So that will give guideline to the clinician. So if it is regenerative, definitely that problem is with bone marrow or kidney. So they will think about other options, treatment options. Okay. So this is Babesia gibsoni or canine Babesia gibsoni. You can see among canine Babesia canis and Babesia gibsoni. Babesia gibsoni is highly pathogenic. Remember, they are causing heavy hemolytic crisis. I have seen that hemoglobin normally reaches to 2 to 3 milligram gram per deciliter. Sometimes normally it is below 4 or 5. But some cases I have seen already in some texts. Now there is I have got one or two cases they are having above 13 or 14 hemoglobin. Then also they are heavy positive for this Babesia gibsoni. So always try to check when your animals are not responding for conventional antibiotic therapy or something. Try to check the blood smears for this Babesia. Again, this is another view of the same slide. Numerous polychromatic cells are there here. Again, you can see this signature in shape. This is the pyroplasm of the Babesia gibsoni. They are very small in size, even they may not be visible to you pupils. Okay, they are present in numerous RBCs. Here you can see in numerous RBCs they are present there, and these are polychromatic cells. So it is indicating that is regenerative anemia. Okay, here also you can see again numerous 1, 2, 3. So many RBCs are there. They are having polychromatic feature, basophilia. They are nuclear remnants. They are immature erythrocytes. Okay, this one, this one, this one, this one. So many RBCs they are having intracytoplasmic signature in shape. Babesia gibsoni pyroplasm. So this is regarding Babesia gibsoni. Okay. Now this is next photograph. Just you can compare. This is Babesia canis. Although it is not that much pathogenic as compared to Babesia gibsoni, but it is sometimes when your concurrent diseases are there, they are also causing heavy loss. Okay. Now you can just compare. Why I told it is large Babesia. You can see the size. You can just compare. They are pear shaped. They are present in acute angle, just like a bovine forms. Within one RBC, 1, 2, 3, 4, they are present. They are pyriform. Okay. They are pear shape or pyriform. And they are sometimes they are arranged in this acute angle, 30 angle, angle of 30 degree. Okay. Easily you can say this is Babesia canis. So this is a differentiation. Okay. Here also you can see this Babesia canis pyroplasm within RBCs. 1, 2, 3, 4 are present. They are large. They are much, much larger than the Babesia gibsoni. Again, they are having pear shape. Okay. What happened even in case of this Babesia gibsoni, Babesia canis infection, when your heavy infections are there, you can find them outside the RBCs also. That is extracellular forms also easily visible. You can see 1, 2, 3, 4. These are Babesia canis pyroplasm. They are present outside the RBCs. When your heavy hemolysis is there, erythrolysis is there, you can find them outside the cells. So here you can see inside, pear shape, they are present within the RBCs. But here you can see they are just present outside the cells. So when your heavy infections are there, CV hemolysis is there. We can see some many times we can see the spiroplasm. They are even present outside the cells. Extracellular form also present. Okay. So this is regarding babesiosis. That is small babesia, that is Babesia gibsoni, and large babesia, that is Babesia canis. Both are responsible for causing hemolysis. Okay, or severe anemia, jaundice, or hemolytic crisis. Now we'll go ahead. If that is normally we are identifying as a bacteria, mycoplasmosis and all that one. But this mycoplasma again responsible for causing hemolytic anemia, hemolytic crisis in bovines, felines, and canines also. Species are different. In canines, that is Mycoplasma hemocanis. Now you can just, okay. Again, these are also pleomorphic organisms. You can see at the periphery, small dot shape are there. Okay, numerous RBCs. This dog, I think, having two or three some hemoglobin. And you can see numerous RBCs, they are having small dot shape, this Mycoplasma hemocanis organisms. Okay, so when we are getting, and again, you can see numerous metarobocytes are, this is having regenerative anemia. You can see this metarobocyte or immature nuclear erythrocyte, they are present within blood. So this organism, Mycoplasma hemocanis, also again responsible for causing regenerative anemia. So again, it is also responsible for causing hemolytic crisis. Again, you can see the band cell is there. You can see many RBCs, there are small dot-like basophilic organism, they are present at the periphery or center like this one. Okay, numerous. You can see here. So this is Mycoplasma hemocanis. Again, this organism is also responsible for causing severe hemolytic anemia. In canines, even felines and bovines also. Now, next we'll go for canine trypanosomiasis. Normally, trypanosomiasis, when we are just saying, you will think about bovines. But it is not like that one. In canines also, in our country also, many cases have been reported regarding canine trypanosomiasis, typically eastern region. Just you can see, this is canine. In case of canine trypanosomiasis, again, same thing is there. Anemia is not that much pronounced, but we'll see. Normally, in case of, as you have seen in chronic trypanosomiasis in bovines, you'll see corneal opacity is there. In some cases, you'll find in canines also corneal opacity is there, fever is there, lymph node enlargement is there, and some mild to moderate anemia is there. But just now, you can see here, numerous leaflet leaf shape having some flagellates, they are present here. Okay? Trypanosoma organisms here, you can see. Numerous they are present. Here also again you can see the clumps of these trypanosoma organisms. They are present within the smear. You can see. But in case of this trypanosomiasis, you will see severe evenemated response is there. Now you can see in blood smear also agglutination is there. Severe numerous agglutinates they are present. So this indicate evenemated hemolytic anemia. In trypanosomiasis, frequently we will see this agglutination is there. Evenemated response is there. Okay, you can see numerous clumps, they are agglutinated just like a bunch of grapes, like a bunch of grapes. Rolex formation, that is another differentiation. They are, in case of Rolex formation, the RBCs, they are arranged like a stack of coins. You may have seen the stack of coins, just putting one over another. That is Rolex formation. In case of agglutination, you will find these are just arranged like a, this is arrangement of RBCs, like a bunch of grapes. So this is agglutination, and that is typical feature of the immunomated hemolytic anemia. Again, you will see numerous spirocytes are there. Spirocytosis, that is another hallmark of the immunomated hemolytic anemia. Just you can see next slides. Normally, the canine RBCs, they are having slight central pallor. Okay. Again, they are very large in size, 7 to 8 micrometer something size is there. But you can see many slides, many RBCs, you can see they are having small RBCs, central pallor is lacking. So they are called as spirocytes. So agglutination, spirocytosis, they are the typical hallmark of the immunomated hemolytic anemia. Then we are treating for babesiosis, trypanosomiasis, or other infectious diseases, sometimes in neoplastic disorders, kindly check for immunomated hemolytic anemia. If it is there, although proper treatment is there also hemoglobin continuously declines. And these animals are dying. Even I have, from last 3 years, I am conducting study on bovines also. Bovines is very rare. Not that much studied animal, or that much studied species in case of immunomated hemolytic anemia. So last 3 years, I have seen many bovine cases also there. In bovine also, same condition is there. Lots of animals, they are treated for thyrosis, babesiosis, timely. Then also they are dying. Hemoglobin is decreasing. It is due to the immunomated hemolytic anemia. Okay. So same, numerous trypanosome organisms, leaf-like organisms, they are having flagellates. Okay, and that is undulating membrane. Here you can see they are present. So that is canine trypanosomiasis. Now we'll go for another disorder. Although it is not causing significant loss, but they're responsible for causing chronic disorder or chronic wasting in case of canines. Okay, that is canine hepatogenosis, that is hepatogen canis. In America, different forms are there, that is canine hepatogen americanum something. In our area, mostly we'll see that is hepatogen canis. Okay, now how to identify this one? Just normally, whatever 90% neutrophils, sometimes in monocytes or lymphocytes also. But normally, 90% in cases, you see, they are present within the neutrophils. Here you can see, they are just like a bullet shape or cigar shape. Okay, bullet shape organism, hepatogen canis organism, they are present within the neutrophils. So sometimes just you can see here, 1, 2, here also you can see, 1, 2. Cigar shape organism, they are present within the neutrophils. Sometimes 90% neutrophils are getting affected. And these animals typically suffer to the secondary bacterial infections or other diseases, concurrent diseases, due to the immunosuppression. Okay, so this is regarding canine hepatogenosis. Now we'll go for another after babesiosis, major problem in clinical setup, that is canine ehrlichiosis. So this canine ehrlichiosis morphologically or whatever cells they are found, it is divided into three categories. Monocytic, that is ehrlichia canis, that is present in monocytes. Granulocytic ehrlichiosis, that is another species of the ehrlichia, they are present in granulocytes. Typically neutrophils, eosinophils, they are present. Okay, this morulae, they are basically rickettsia or a bacterial type of organisms, cocci. Then they are present, they are found in just morulae or clumps within cytoplasm of epithelial cells. Ehrlichia canis, that is present in monocytes. This is morulae, they are present in monocytes. Ehrlichia evingi, that is present in granulocytes of the canines. And thrombocytic, this again very hard to diagnose with blood smear. You have to go for some molecular techniques or lateral flow assays. That is Anaplasma platys. Previously it is called as Ehrlichia platys, but nowadays it is again reclassified into another category, that is Anaplasma platys. It is responsible for cyclical thrombocytopenia in canines. Okay, so already I told, whenever we are getting thrombocytopenia or marked decrease of thrombocytes in canine, in CBC, always we are suspecting for canine ehrlichiosis. So these are the three types of ehrlichiosis or ehrlichia, they are responsible for causing thrombocytopenia in canines. We will see one by one in blood smears. Okay. So in canine ehrlichiosis, this one case, just you can see, this is IDEX FODEX kit. It is a multi-purpose kit. It is a lateral flow assay normally. It is detecting antibodies of the ehrlichia. Okay. So all three types of ehrlichia easily can be diagnosed with this kit. This is called as something FODEX test something in IDEX catalog. Here you can see, this is positive control and this is just a sample, positive sample, just you can see here. Okay. Okay. So this one is a positive mark. Again, this one is for ehrlichia canis or ehrlichia evingi. FODEX means that is diagnosing four conditions. That's why it is called as FODEX. Again, it is very helpful for diagnosis of Lyme disease, that is Borrelia burgdorferi. Again, in case of ehrlichia, this Anaplasma phagocytophilum, Anaplasma platys, they can be also diagnosed with this kit. And again, very importantly, another disorder, that is dyroplerimitis or heartworm, that can be also diagnosed. In case of dyroplerimitis, it is detecting antigen. In case of Borrelia burgdorferi, it is detecting antigen. But in case of ehrlichia, this kit is detecting antibodies. So sometimes false positive reactions are there. Okay. So this is positive reaction for ehrlichia canis. And here you can see in blood smear, very typically, this is basophilic morula that is present within cytoplasm of monocyte. This is the kidney shaped nucleus, you can see. Okay. This is monocyte and this is cytoplasm. Within cytoplasm, just you can see very typical morula. So whenever we are getting this thrombocytopenia, lymphadenopathy is there, fever is there, animal having history of fever, cyclical fever, sometimes in case of Anaplasma platys, we should check for blood smear examination. But remember, in case of this is one example I am only showing, very frequently it's very hard to diagnose ehrlichiosis with blood smear, direct blood smear, whatever regularly we are performing. You require lots of time, you have to spend lots of time. If it is not possible, if you want to diagnose with blood smear only, if you are not having some lateral flow assay, kindly go for buffy coat smear examination. Buffy coat that constitute the leukocytes, just take hematocrit tip, as normally we are going for hematocrit reader, go for spinning, that is just like a PCB stimulation, and just break that tube and take the buff report over your blood smear, and just prepare smear as a blood smear. We can, that will maximize the chances to get positive. Okay, so when you are diagnosing ehrlichiasis or tick bite fever with blood smear examination, kindly go for buff report examination. If you are not having lateral bloodiasis, again you have to correlate with the clinical signs and symptoms also. Okay, this is regarding IDEX lateral bloodiasis. This is very helpful for diagnosis of all types of ehrlichiasis. Again, heartworm. In case of heartworm, it is very reliable because it is detecting antigen. Okay, in case of Lyme disease also, Borrelia burgdorferi, it is detecting antigen. But in case of Ehrlichia canis, ehrlichiasis, typically canine ehrlichiasis, kindly correlate your findings with blood smear or clinical findings. Okay, because these kids, they are detecting antibodies. Because after even your treatment also, 2 to 3 months, these antibodies remains in body. If you are checking after 1 or 2 months, you'll find that dog is positive. But these antibodies, they're remaining there. They will remain there for 1 to 2 months or 3 months in your body. So because they are detecting antibodies, always you should check. You should correlate your lateral bloodiasis results with the clinical findings, as well as sometimes with blood smear examination or buff report examination. Okay. Now, although this canine pleuritis diagnosis is somewhat hard, but this one case is there. Again, I have checked this one with the lateral bloodiasis also. Here you can see, these are platelets. How much big they are? So they are even more than the size of RBCs. And these numerous morules, they are present with the, within the cytoplasm of the platelets. Here also you can see, okay, this one is here and here also. There, again, I have checked with, because alone blood smear examination, alone these findings are not possible to reach to diagnosis. You have to correlate with the some lateral bloodiasis. So clinical signs are there, possible thrombocytopenia. This dog was having cyclical thrombocytopenia. Again, blood smear also typical morules, they are present within platelets. Again, I have checked my diagnosis with lateral bloodiasis, that is also positive. So by this way, you can diagnose. This is again very rare picture. Normally, it's very hard to diagnose anaplasma platis from blood smear, but this is one case I got. Just I'm sharing with you all. Again, here also you can see a typical morules, they are present within the thrombocytes. Okay, these are immature platelets. Within these platelets, you can see numerous basophilic, these morules of the anaplasma platis, they are present. And in case of anaplasma platis, remember cyclical thrombocytopenia is there. For 1 or 2 days, that dog is having normal count. Again, after 1 or 2 days, that dog is having low count. That is called a cyclical thrombocytopenia. So anaplasma platis or anaplasma, this Ehrlichia platis, that is responsible for cyclical thrombocytopenia in canines. If such symptoms are there, kindly check for lateral bloodiasis or blood smear. Typically go for anaplasma platis treatment. Okay, now we have seen the infectious diagnosis of infectious inclusions or infectious diseases, canine infectious diseases from blood smear, and in these all things. Okay, now we will go for hematological malignancies. Before that one, I think we'll go for immune-mediated hemolytic anemia, and then we'll go for hematological malignancies. Okay, so already I told weight mounts also very helpful for diagnosis of number of diseases. Maybe blood weight mount, urine weight mount, body fluid weight mount, fecal weight mounts. They are very easy and rapid diagnostic techniques, and they are very reliable. Typically, in case of immune-mediated hemolytic anemia, then diagnosis of trypanosomiasis. And some other diseases also I will show that. Okay. This one, I have shown in case of babesiosis, even ehrlichiosis, some neoplastic disorders. Although timely diagnosis is there, timely treatment is there, then also animals are dying. Correct diagnosis is there. That dog was having a babesia gypsumi. I have diagnosed, treatment was correct. Even transfusion was done. Then also these animals are dying. Why? So normally we are not thinking about these immune-mediated responses. For each and every infection, our body is producing immune-mediated response. This immune-mediated hemolytic anemia, that is very big culprit in case of severe cases. Typically, these animals, whatever animals, they are having 6, 5 or below 4 hemoglobin. Check, very simple technique is there. Check, just take a drop of blood, put over the glass slide, same quantity of. As a 1:4, or sometimes we are using 1:2. If I took just 10 microliter of blood, put 20 microliter of normal saline, or 1:4, sometimes we have to use dilution. That is, take 10 microliter of blood, and 40 microliter of normal saline, mix it properly, put cover slip and go for examination. Very simple. Okay. Even in severe cases, you can see this is vacutainer, BD vacutainer. If you are using good quality vacutainers, just you can see inner wall of this vacutainer, you can see small clumps are there. If you are having good experience of laboratory, if you are regularly working in laboratory, even from just keep that vial for mix and keep for some time, 10 or 15, 20 minutes, easily you can see inner wall of these vacutainers, easily you can see clumps. They are agglutinates. Typically, it is indicating IMHA, that is immunomodulated hemoglobin. Here, just wet mount. I took just a drop of this blood, mixed with 1:4 or 1:2 dilution of the normal saline, put cover slip and go for examination. You can see numerous agglutinates are there. Okay. The whole list here, you can see this here also. This is just like a bunch of grapes. Okay. Bunch of grapes you can see. These are agglutinates are there. So this is a very easy technique for diagnosis. Although numerous other techniques are, Coombs tests are there, other things are there. But there are some, they will take time. Again, cost is more. So this is a very easy technique. And side by you can check. And many even clinicians, they are performing this test for diagnosis of immunomodulated hemolytic anemia. Okay. So this is regarding immunomodulated hemolytic anemia. Again, we'll go back and we'll see some hematological malignancies. So from blood smear, again, we can go for diagnosis of numerous neoplastic diseases or cancers, and typically leukemia. Okay. So this leukemia normally divided into two categories, acute lymphoid leukemia and chronic lymphoid leukemia. What is the difference? You'll ask, chronic and acute, we have got different habit. But here, chronic and acute, they are having some other morphological difference. In case of chronic lymphoid leukemia, you will see mature lymphocytes. Cells are small in size, just you can see here. Okay, they are small in size. Very scanty cytoplasm is there. Again, the nucleus, they are just looking like a normal lymphocytes. But count is very huge. That is chronic lymphoid leukemia. And these chronic lymphoid leukemia cases, they can survive better. They will respond better and they will live at least 2 to 3 years. No issue if you go on for good supportive care and all that. Acute lymphoid leukemia, you will see numerous lymphoblasts are there. I am not having slides with me right now. But lymphoblasts, slides, this neoplastic cells, they are bigger in size. They are having multiple nucleoli. This is not chronic acute lymphoid leukemia. This is chronic only. Okay. They are bigger in size. They are having very big sizes. Blast. They are immature lymphoblasts. They are having numerous nucleoli. Basophilic cytoplasm. And in case of acute lymphoid leukemia, prognosis of the patient is not good. Remember, hardly 1 year something that this dog will live. So why I'm telling this chronic and acute? Because it is related with the life of patient. Whenever it is chronic type of lymphoid leukemia, patient will live. If good supportive care is there, palliative treatment is there, these dogs can live 3 to 4 years, 2, 3, 4 or something here. But if acute lymphoid leukemia is there, you are getting numerous blast cells, immature cells, mitotic fibers are there. These cases never will live. That is acute lymphoid leukemia. That I am not having that case right now with me. But this case I got. Just you can see, this is German Shepherd dog, hardly 3 to 3.5 years old male. Hemoglobin is around 6. Total leukocyte count, that was near about 2,36,000. Then these are other parameters due to invasion. Remember, okay, AgO2 dissolves, alkaline phosphatase increases there due to bone marrow invasion. All these things are there. Even sometimes renal involvement is there. These neoplastic cells, they are invading the even liver, kidneys, spleen, and all these organs. So in these circumstances, we'll find these biochemical parameters are very much important. To just check multi-organ involvement or multi-organ failure. Okay, here you can see these neoplastic cells. Although they are looking like a normal lymphocytes or mature lymphocytes, but numerous are there. Again, already I took, in case of neoplastic disease also, agglutination is very common. Okay, you can see numerous agglutinates are there. Okay, in breast milk also. So immunomodulatory response is always there in case of neoplasia also. Wet mounts, again, all day we have seen the IMHA. In case of neoplasia also, all day I have shown immunomodulatory responses are there. You have to check for this one also. Now we will go for another technique, that is urine analysis. One case I got, this is normally called as Lyme nephritis. All day I have shown is that rapid diagnostic kit also. That is caused by Borrelia burgdorferi. Why? Just we can see here. This dog is having some long duration problem with kidneys. Dog, Pomeranian, near about 12 year old dog with history of chronic renal failure. Lateral flow assay, I got positive for Borrelia burgdorferi. They sent me urine sample. So just I took wet mount. You can see this Borrelia species, Leptospira species, they are just like a spirus. They are called as spirochetes basically. Spirochetes means they are having spiral shape, just like a spring. Their shape is just like a spring. They are just like a spring, or they are that's why they are called as spirochetes. This is one of the them. The spirochetes, this Borrelia is there. They are also again responsible for causing nephritis, Lyme nephritis. Just you can see here video. Okay, this is wet mouth. Just I took this one single drop of the urine, kept coarsely, and just you can see this, they are showing some spiral movements there. Okay. Again, I have checked with this lateral flow also, that was positive for Borrelia species. So when we are getting these chronic nephritis cases, kindly check for these infectious agents also. Borrelia species, Leptospira species, they're also equally responsible. Here you can see how they are moving. Okay. Just in between somewhere, that will show spiral movement. So now you can see clear spiral movement is there. They are continuously rotating around longitudinal axis. Okay. So this is one case I got. Only till today I have got this single case only. Again, I have checked with the clinical findings, already it was there, clinical signs were matching. Again, I have checked with this lateral flow assay for Borrelia burgdorferi, that is positive. Okay. This is regarding Lyme nephritis. Now, another thing normally we are assessing in case of uric acid or renal Caligula issues in canines or felines. But why we are checking? Just we want to know the composition of these stones or Caligula. They are present in urinary tract. Here we can see these crystals, they are very frequent coffin shape. That is triple phosphate crystals. Many of these are there. You can suspect something composition of the urinary Caligula. Very important this one. This I got one case. This is ammonium biurate crystals from the urine sediment. I got one case that was having severe jaundice. I took the blood sample, this urine sample, and I got from blood sediment examination. We can see numerous this ammonium biurate crystals are there, and they are having thorn apple. These small small thorns, and numerous thorns are there. Thorn apple like morphology is there, like sarcoptic mage or thorn apple appearance. Numerous thorns you can see. Okay, so numerous they are present. Here we are getting these ammonium biurate crystals in urine, numerous. This is typical finding of the hepatic failure. Remember, whenever hepatic failures are there. Hepatic damage is there, hepatic disorders are there. Always check. When you are suspecting, kindly check for urine examination. When you are getting this kind of findings in urine examination, you can suspect for hepatic failure. Okay. So this is very important finding in case of hepatic diseases or hepatic failure in canines. Okay. They are called as ammonium biurate crystals. Just you can see here. This is urine. How much it is dark, yellow. Again, here you can see the morphology of that crystals, ammonium biurate crystals that typically you will see in case of hepatic failure in canines. Okay. They are thorn apple like morphology there. Now, I am going to share another case. You may think why I am showing this case here. Although it is case from flying side, in canines also this diarrhea has been reported from USA and other countries. Normally, previously we are Trichomonas fetus and all that, we are considering them as a abortion agents, abortion etiology in bovines. But now the trend is changing. The Trichomonas fetus, they are associated with feline diarrhea, typically sometimes in canine diarrhea also. Okay, this one case I got for a fecal sample from cattery, and this the foul smelling diarrhea was there. These cats were having foul smelling diarrhea. She that the owner told. And just interestingly, I got for some worm oocyte or worm egg examination something. I was checking, but I was surprised. Just you can see here. This is video of the same wet mouth. Just you can see. Okay. Okay, just you can see, this is 2.5 year male cat with history of malodorous waxy diarrhea containing mucus. Again, I have checked for Giardia lateral flow assay also there from IDEX, that was found negative. Again, direct fecal smear examination revealed numerous trichomonas. How I diagnose that trichomonas? Just how to differentiate between Giardia and trichomonas? Just remember, they are having rigorous forward movement, and Giardia, they are just rotating like a falling leaf. If some leaf is falling from the branch of some tree, just you'll see that is rotating while falling. So falling leaf-like movement. Giardia, they are having falling leaf-like movement. And these trichomonas, they are having rigorous forward movement. So from these two only morphologies or movements, just you can just check. Again, I was having this Giardia kit. That one also I checked to just differentiate from the Giardia also. Okay. Now you can see. Just this is video of the same wet mouth, fecal wet mouth from the cat. Okay, this GIDA was negative. Here you can see that cat was again this trichomonas, the undulating membrane was there, rigorously forward move. They will move very fastly, straight motion. Just you can see. This is 10x view. Numerous this trichomonas, they are moving here and there, just you can see. Okay, they are moving here and there. Now we can see. Continuously they are moving forward. Rigorously they will move forward. They are continuously moving in forward motion. If GIDA is there, they will just show rotating movement. They will show like a rotating, falling leaf like movement. Okay, so this is regarding the feline diarrhea. Okay, so trichomonas associated feline diarrhea. Whenever we are getting samples from canines or felines, they are having malodorous diarrhea, not responding to antibiotics, and all these things. Check for GIDA and trichomonas also. Okay, now we will go for another technique, that is fine needle aspiration cytology. I think we will go fast. So this is very well-known technique nowadays, that is used for number of disease diagnosis, but commonly we are using for neoplastic disease diagnosis. See, this one case not responding, severe lymphoid enlargement was there. Okay, again this is USG finding, sonography finding, renal involvement, hepatic involvement was there, splenomegaly was there. So they just took this sample from lymph node aspiration, and you can see numerous blast cells are there, lymphoid cells are there, mitotic figure, frequent mitotic figures are there. You can see just two poles are there. Okay, every field they are having metastatic mitotic figures indicating malignancy. Okay, here also you can see blood smears, same thing is there. So it is metastatic lymphoma. Okay, there numerous lymphoblasts, they are present within lymph node aspiration of the lymph nodes. Lymph node aspiration. Now next we will see. Cutaneous plasmacytoma. Okay, here you can see same thing. You will ask me how to differentiate. You can see this. How you can see numerous cells are there. They are having eccentric nuclei. Plasma cells, they are having typically eccentric nuclei. Okay, numerous are there. Mitotic figures are also there. So this is cutaneous plasmacytoma. This is just aspiration from the cutaneous mass from the dog. Again. You have seen this ulcerating masses, hemorrhagic masses, continuously having hemorrhagic tendency over the penis or glass penis or superficial mass. You just take impression smear. In case of females, vaginal masses are there. Even sometimes you can see over the lips also, they are present, these masses are present. They are typical transmission venule tumor, TVT. Okay. These are typically categorized as round cell tumors. You can see round cells, big round cells are there. Frequently, they are having calculations. So this is typical characteristic of the TVT. Again, these cells are this tumor having tendency to exploit, as well as they are having frequent mitotic figures. There no possible. Now we'll go for some viral diseases. Regularly we are going through the canine cases. Many cases we are getting of canine infectious canine hepatitis. Although molecular tests are there, other things are there, but when you are suspecting these animals for ICH. If you are going for necropsy or liver biopsy, just go for simple impression smear technique. Or take biopsy, crush on the blood smear, and go for normal or blood stain. You can see intranuclear inclusions are there. Okay, they are the adenoviral inclusions. Here it is. This is nucleus of the normal hepatocytes, and normal liver cells. Here and here, these arrows, they are showing intranuclear inclusions. So these are adenoviral inclusions. And easily with impression smear during necropsy, or sometimes you are collecting samples with the help of USG guided fine needle aspiration, you can just check for this intranuclear inclusion if you are suspecting that dog is having ICH or infectious canine hepatitis. So these adenoviral inclusions typically you can see within nucleus, intranuclear basophilic inclusions. Even histopathology also they are very clear. Okay. Now next we will go for canine distemper inclusions. From blood smear also easily you can diagnose. Within neutrophils and even within RBCs also they are present. Eosinophilic inclusions, they are present within neutrophils. So sometimes, although they are very hard to get, but you have to search and definitely will get. If you are suspecting that dog is having canine distemper, kindly just check blood smear for presence of these canine distemper inclusions. They are eosinophilic inclusions present within the cytoplasm of neutrophils. Again, although this is bovine brain, previously we have gone through some cases, but immediately in hurry I could not find this photograph, histopathological photographs, for only information purpose. This is also from my side only. This is buffalo calf having clinical signs of the rabies. In case of bovines, these negri bodies, they are typically present in cerebellum. In case of canines, they are, although they are present all over throughout the brain, but easily you can see a cerebellum or a Purkinje cells. Okay, now just one or two months back, we have gone through near about 10 to 12 cases of bovines. I have seen carefully, these inclusions are present in within whole brain. Don't say like this one, they are present within only cerebellum or all these things. They are present in cerebellum and they are easily visible and they are present in more quantity in cerebellum. But if you see carefully in histopathology, you can see these inclusions are present in all neurons in brain. Okay. Right now, I could not find their photographs. I will show you if possible later on in later presentation. So this is cerebellum. You can see this is eosinophilic. This is a nucleus of the neuron. Okay. And you can see multiple, this is intracytoplasmic eosinophilic inclusions are there. These are the negri bodies. Okay, you can see here. This is nucleus of the neuron, Purkinje cell. And here you can see the multiple negri bodies that are present within the cytoplasm of the intracytoplasmic inclusions of the this Lysa virus is there. Okay, this is nucleus of the neuron. Okay, same thing you can see in canine source. Only in canines, they are present in more quantity in hippocampus. Otherwise, if you see carefully in histopathology, they are present in each and every neuron. Okay, thank you. So this is again another photograph. You can see how many negri bodies they are present within the cytoplasm of the Purkinje cells. This is again demodecosis, very familiar issue. If you took skin scrapping, you can see cigar shape. These demodex canines, they are present within the skin scrapping. Thank you. I hope I took lots of time. If you have any questions, you can ask. Otherwise, you can stop. You can send me questions later on. Right now, if you are.
Thank you, sir. I think probably a very, very few questions I could see.
Okay, sir.
One has asked between the difference between the regenerative and non-regenerative anemia.
Okay. Already I have shown. From CBC also you can check. In case of canines, near about if you are getting reticulocyte count more than 3 to 4%. If you want to just assess from the CBC, then go for reticulocyte count. If you want to assess from the blood smear, kindly check for the polychromatic cells or immature RBCs. Already I have shown in Babesia egyptiae that slide. I have shown numerous polychromatic cells, immature RBCs, they are present. From that one, easily you can diagnose that anemia is regenerative type. And it is very important in case of clinical setup.
One participant has asked about the how to differentiate between Mycoplasma hemocanis and Howell Jolly bodies.
Howell Jolly bodies, they are very larger in size and they are having dark basophilic. They are dark basophilic, remember. They are dark basophilic and sometimes they are having small halo around them. They are having small halo around them. They are larger in size. And frequently we'll see they are present in regenerative anemia. This Mycoplasma hemocanis, they are sometimes you can see they are in the signature in shape also, but they are very small in size than Howell Jolly bodies.
One question is there, sir. What should be the percentage of spherocytes to rule out immune mediated hemolytic anemia?
No such measurement is there. They are the hallmark. Remember, they are the hallmark of the spherocytosis. Not only spherocyte count, you have to go for agglutination also. Okay, you have to consider agglutination, spherocytosis, both things, not alone spherocytosis.
Other question that you already explained, so I think there is no need about later. You already explained it well. I think the questions are over, sir. Okay, and thank you very much. I would now request our co-coordinator, Dr. Mahesh Ingole, sir, to offer a vote of thanks. Dr. Ingole, sir, please.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Now, on behalf of the organizing committee, I am thankful Dr. Sambhaji Chavan, Assistant Professor, Department of Veterinary Pathology, College of Veterinary Animal Sciences, Udgir, for sharing his own experiences in the diagnosis of laboratory diagnosis of some of the important diseases of canines. And as we are going, that means most of veterinarians, they are going for the therapeutics for the various canine diseases. Correct diagnosis of the disease is utmost important, and the role of pathologist is there. So if you go with the correct diagnosis, its therapeutic management becomes easier and correct. So from organizers, PJVS and university, I am really thankful for sharing your own experiences and enriching the and refreshing the knowledge of this laboratory diagnosis, which will be definitely helpful in the management of the various diseases in the canines. So lastly, I am thankful to all the today's